Thanks so much. Good afternoon, brothers. So good to be together, isn't it? And I bring you greetings from snowy, cold Denver, Colorado, where my wife got to scrape snow off the front porch for her Mother's Day present this morning. I've got a little bit to make up for when I get home, I think, right? This is my first time to be here. Alistair and I have known one another for a number of years. We used to be part of what we affectionately called the preach-off back at the Master's College. I was an associate pastor and personal assistant to John MacArthur for a number of years and met Alistair then. But he would bring some guys in and each of us would preach a different day for a week just as an excuse to play golf all afternoon, basically. And we've had the opportunity to interact with Alistair over the years and delighted that we can be together. How many of you, this is your first time at this particular conference, at the Basics Conference? Oh, great. Well, welcome, brothers. We're going to enjoy this together and so thankful that we'll have some fellowship as we do share. Our ministry, I think that we have some slides. It's called Strategic Renewal. You're welcome to stop by sometime. Basically, as was already said, I was a pastor for several decades. I still serve as the prayer pastor and on the preaching team in Littleton, Colorado, Mission Hills Church. But basically went from being a senior pastor to a full-time spiritual pyromaniac. With a real passion out of my own pastoral journey to help equip pastors to really develop cultures of prayer in their church. And so that's what we do. We also have, and I'll just mention it briefly, a fellowship nationally that is around focused around the verses from Acts chapter 6 and verse 4, which most of you, of course, know. We will give ourselves continually to prayer in the ministry of the Word, and certainly invite you to stop by and check that out. Lots of resources on a regular basis, just basically to keep our passion for preaching and also for prayer fueled, and Alistair's been very involved with us in that, and several others. We actually started with about 50 pastors, and one of them with whom I travel fairly frequently is Pastor Jim Simble at the Brooklyn Tabernacle. I'm kind of an ecumenical mutt. I was an associate pastor and personal assistant to Jerry Falwell, then as I mentioned to John MacArthur, and now Jim Simble. So if I have a friend left in the crowd, I'm usually lucky after all of that, right? But wonderful to see how God uses that. And of course, Jim in particular with his passion for prayer and the amazing example of their prayer effort there. I want to show you a video very briefly about a conference we're having in Colorado, just a 1 minute video. And I want you to just see this because Alistair's going to be there. So if you don't get enough of him here, you gotta come join us in Colorado and you'll have the opportunity to see him there. I think we have that queued up. Yeah, here we go. You get to watch that just real quick, and then we'll dig into our content for the afternoon. I love the scenery anyway, if nothing else. There we go. So that's at the end of July, and when it's 100% humidity and 90 degrees where you live, come cool off with us and get encouraged as we share in that time together, and very much looking forward to that. Again, you can get some more information about that. Today we want to talk about developing a culture of prayer, and throughout the scripture, particularly in the book of Acts, we see that prayer was not just one of the programs, it wasn't a department. It wasn't an activity assigned to the left-hand older women's knitting league. It was actually the very core and culture of the church. And I love the way Ian Bounds says it. You see this quote here, and many of you have read his works, very convicting and challenging. He says, "Prayer cannot be retired as a secondary force in this world. To do so is to retire God from the movement. It is to make God secondary. The prayer ministry is an all-engaging force. It must be so to be a force at all. The estimate in place of prayer is the estimate in place of God. To give prayer the secondary place is to make God secondary in life's affairs. To substitute other forces for prayer retires God and materializes the whole movement. And then it goes on to say, if I can get this little thing to work here, I guess you're going to have to, there we go, all right? Too far, all right. How easy to neglect prayer or abbreviate our praying simply by the plea that we have church work on our hands. Satan has effectively disarmed us when he can keep us too busy doing things to stop and pray. I believe from my years of pastoral ministry and working with pastors around the country, and I think we all would agree, that the devil doesn't have to destroy us, he simply has to distract us. And when he distracts us away from the primary sources of what really provides for supernatural gospel impact, then he has won the day. As we look at the early church, we find that, again, the church was marked by a culture of prayer. We won't look at any particular verse, but just in kind of skipping the stone across the body of truth in the book of Acts, you know that it was started in Acts chapter 1, verse 14, as they all, together with one accord, were devoting themselves to prayer. Acts 2:42, as the church was launched, again, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, fellowship, breaking of bread, and prayers. Acts 3, we see Peter and John going up to the temple to pray when this wonderful miracle happens. Persecution breaks out. Chapter 4, they immediately come together again and praying out of the scripture, claiming the promises of God. They seek the Lord for fresh boldness. Chapter 5 tells us again, they're gathering in the temple. Chapter 6, as you know, the early church leader said, we will give ourselves continually to prayer and the ministry of the word. And it goes on and on and on. Peter's in jail. The church is praying. Acts chapter 13, the second part of the book of Acts, where missions is launched, comes out of the leaders fasting and ministering to the Lord. And so we understand in the early church there was an amazing sense of prayer. Now our problem is that we live in an Acts-oriented culture, don't we? I mean, you think of some of the slogans that mark our day, get it done, or that great theologian Larry the Cable Guy, get her done. Some of you, you should know who he is, but I noticed some of you did. Anyway, lead, follow, get out of the way. One of them so classic in our society is don't just sit there, what? Do something, right? If you look at the book of Acts, it was very different. It was don't just do something, sit there and wait for the power of the Holy Spirit. And I think one of the big differences between our culture today as we seek to serve the Lord and the New Testament culture was that they actually believed that the Holy Spirit was the how-to. We believe the Holy Spirit helps us, the Holy Spirit will come alongside, etc. But they actually believed he was the how-to. And of course, he takes the Word of God as we preach it and makes it effective. He guides and prompts and leads. Our problem is we have far too many other how-tos, don't we? I mean, sometimes in my mind, I think, why should I pray for an hour when I could Google this in 10 seconds and get some smart guy's answer, right? But we need a fresh understanding of the role of the Holy Spirit as we pray, as we wait on the Lord with open scriptures, and we sense His power and His leading in all that we do. So today we want to talk about that idea of a culture of prayer. Let me give you just a brief amount of background. First of all, to start with a confession, which I think will put you at ease. And that is, I'm not a natural prayer guy, and I think probably most of you would agree. Prayer is depending on God, and I by nature am fiercely independent. Some of you automatically relate to that. My friends tell me I could be stranded on a desert island for a week and never realize that I'm the only one there. I'd be having so much fun, you know, collecting coconuts, building huts, you know, fishing, and hey, where is everybody, right? I often say it this way, that prayerlessness is my declaration of independence from God. In fact, say that with me, will you? Prayerlessness is my declaration of independence from God. Very easy to get up in the day, even with many ministry duties, and run on Christian autopilot and say, Lord, I'll check in with you if I get in trouble, but I think I'm okay for now. So that's not my nature. I've met some natural prayer guys. They're a little bit mystical, kind of weird sometimes. They look like they've been hanging out in the Baptist monastery, wearing the robe, swinging their incense, dripping Shekinah juice, glowing in the dark, and that's not me at all. I'm just a normal guy, but over the years, God has taken me on a journey that I think will encourage you. And it really began as I finished seminary, and I came across this passage that has been so influential in my life, and I'm sure many of yours, and that is Acts chapter 6 and verse 4, where the early church leaders confronted with what probably was one of the closest or the most important dilemmas that the church could deal with, and that was feeding the widows, and yet refused to actually get involved in organizing the program or administrating the strategy. I often say when it comes to leadership that the power of no is in a stronger yes. It's hard to say no, isn't it? One of my elders always used to say, Daniel, no is a Christian word. In fact, I love to promote some interaction, and this will be very therapeutic for you. Turn to the brother next to you, look him in the eye, and just say no. It's going to feel really good. You haven't done that for a while, right? Yeah. Kind of empowering, isn't it? But see, the power of no is in a stronger yes. And the reason they were able to say no, first of all, they knew the Holy Spirit was going to raise up competent guys to take care of this, but they knew what their yeses were. Their yeses were prayer, the ministry of the word, and then empowering others and equipping them to lead. I realized that after 7 years of seminary, I had all kinds of training in the ministry of the word, as many of you have. Homiletics, hermeneutics, hermardiology, soteriology, eschatology, pneumatology, all the ologies, isms, schisms, spasms of all my biblical learning, which was great, but I had a goose egg when it came to prayer. Not only was my prayer life struggling, but I had no idea as to what it would practically mean when Jesus said my house would be a house of prayer, as to what that would look like, how to do it, how to lead life-giving prayer times. Most of the prayer meetings I led, I was praying for the rapture halfway through them myself, right? I knew something's not right here. The kind of the slogan of most prayer meetings I led was, we've fallen and we can't get up. And so I prayed a dangerous prayer. I said, Lord, teach me what the first part of that passage means, prayer and the ministry of the word. That's kind of like praying for patience, right? If you've ever prayed for patience, you recognize the only way to learn that, and that is through pain and difficulty. I have learned over the years that the pathway to prayer is always somehow deeply connected to desperation. Either desperation through crises or a cultivation of that desperation. But on that journey, just very briefly, God assigned me to three churches. One of them, at the age of 30, was a church in California where the pastor had been there for 28 years. The church had grown from 60 to 6,000, and in 1988, he had confessed that he had covered up a year-long affair over a period of 8 years. The church was in all kinds of turmoil, embroiled in a $25 million lawsuit, and as I said, at the ripe age of 30, I came in with a tiger by its tail. If you've ever been in a situation like that, you learn that hurting people hurt others, right? They should have told us that in seminary because it's so true. And those were very, very painful years. I always say I was there as long as my predecessor because in dog years, my 4 years equaled his 28, right? And some of you are in your dog years right now. But out of that, God planted a desperation in my heart to realize if we didn't pray, if we didn't seek the Lord, there's no way this church was going to recover. Today they're doing very well. A guy named Chip Ingram pastors the church out there in California, and we saw God bring recovery, but prayer was a vital part of that. My next assignment was a church where I followed the only pastor who had been there for 40 years. So you know that's just a different flavor of pain, right? The phrase du jour when I got there was, we've never done it that way before. Anybody heard that in their church? I'm sure you have. A very, very traditional church, but in the almost 12 years I was there, the Lord allowed us to lead 33 three-day prayer summits where we went away to a retreat center with no agenda, scripture reading, worship, and just seeing how the Lord would lead us to begin to pray. The first one we ever did, it was an amazing thing. In 3 days, we had people delivered from lifelong addiction, marriages healed, racial reconciliation, people called to ministry. The stuff you typically put on your ministry plan for the next 5 years all happened in 3 days. And I was kind of addicted to this thing. I realized, you know, God is always glad to oblige when we give him our undivided attention. And the Lord began to do something in that church. And I won't give you all the details, but church planting and missions, it led to a weekly prayer time with 400 to 500 people there every week. I didn't know what I was doing. All I knew is that the more we prayed, the more God seemed to work. And I began to realize that this really is something that the Lord wants to do in his church. I thought I'd learned enough about prayer until God hijacked me to a church in Minnesota that had just relocated to a new piece of property. It was a $70 million project. Their mortgage was $18 million, and then they also fell $10 million short in their capital campaign. So that was a total of $28 million, and 6 weeks into their new building, they found out their pastor was having an affair. So some of you are looking at me saying, you know, you're really not too smart, Henderson. This is not the kind of assignment you really want. But I think all of it was a fruit of that prayer that I prayed, God continuing to bring us to places of desperation and realizing unless we seek him and faithfully teach his word, we would be in a heap of trouble. And so the Lord brought restoration in all three of those cases. and implanted in me not only a passion to see the church become a house of prayer, but through the School of Hard Knocks, some lessons that proved to be very helpful, not only to us, but to others who came along. I'll just tell you briefly about my vision. Of course, I'm not real big. You ever try to preach on vision from the Bible? It's not a whole lot in there, right? But the dream that wakes me up is this, and don't write it down, your pen will smoke, but you'll relate to it. Giving my life to what I call pastor-led, local church-oriented movements of Christ-exalting, worship-based prayer, leading to a full-scale revival, supernatural evangelism, and cultural transformation. Now, I broke all the rules of vision. It's supposed to be like real pithy, five words, whatever. But this is what wakes me up every day. The men just like us will have our hearts arrested to do the things that are very clear in the Scripture as the primary pastoral priorities, that we would lead our churches to a Christ-exalting, Spirit-birth movement of what I describe, many of you are familiar with this, worship-based prayer, not request-based prayer. Most of our praying in our churches has to do with grocery lists. One of my mentors, a guy named Peter Lord, says most Christians pray out of crisis or a grocery list period. And of course, worship-based prayer is not only the biblical model Jesus gave us, but we all know the power of seeking God's face before we seek His hand. I often say if all we do is seek God's hand, we may miss His face, but if we seek His face, He'll be glad to open His hand. Leading to what I believe could be a full-scale revival. We don't produce revival, it's a sovereign act of God, but we certainly can meet the conditions, should the wind of revival blow, that we would have our sails set to catch it. Supernatural evangelism, because as you brothers know, the great movements of evangelism in our history did not occur because we wrote new curriculum. They occurred because the church was revived 150 years ago in a population base of just 30 million. 2 million people came to Christ in 2 years. And I believe that our nation needs that today. And then, of course, ultimately transforming our culture. We see it's a very dark culture out there. You just have to watch the news, look at the newspaper. But I think we all agree the issue out there is not the pervasiveness of the darkness. It's the failure of the light. And may God give us a passion to see a great work of revival in our churches, really beginning just in the natural realm of our own pastoral ministry. Imagine what God could do. So let's talk about seven vital truths. Now, when I preach, I never have 7 points, just a few points, but you all are extra smart, you're pastors, and this is a kind of a seminar format, and I think it'll be very, very helpful to you. Things that God has helped me with, that we're actively involved with pastors in teaching, that I trust will be practical and helpful to you. First of all, is that a prayer culture is not a prayer program. A prayer culture is not a prayer program. I think too often we feel a sense of conviction about prayer, and we think, well, what we need to do is design a prayer department or a prayer brochure or a prayer committee and start some prayer activities. As I mentioned, I have the privilege of traveling with Jim Cimbala. We do one-day events around the country for pastors, and Jim and I have very different backgrounds, but a similar passion for pastors related to prayer. And he comments on how often pastors will come to their church and they'll see their Tuesday night prayer meeting that attracts thousands every week, and they'll go back and they think the answer is to start a Tuesday night prayer meeting. And they get all excited about that, they promote it, and the first week maybe 100 show up, week 2, 50, week 3 it's 20, week 4 it's the pastor's wife and his dog, and week 5 it's the dog, right? And something just didn't really happen there in terms of seeing prayer occur. The problem with viewing prayer as a program is what tends to happen in the church is you have the same small group of what we might call prayer fanatics who go around to all the prayer events, but the bulk of the church is hardly even aware that it's going on and certainly not touched by it. So we got to understand that it's not a program, but it is really a culture. And let me just show you the difference here. And if you can see those circles, you see the kind of the center of church leadership as we think about a ministry. And around that, you have the different departments, seniors, music, women, youth, whatever it might be. And you see one of those circles is prayer. And when we tend to view prayer as one of the activities of the church, it gets about that much attention and energy. The better way to look at it is that in the center of church life, in the center of the leadership culture, is embedded the reality of prayer. We say really the idea of praying leadership at the center of the church. And I think that diagram helps us. We often say there's a difference between a church that prays and a praying church. Every church prays, right? We practice what I call zipper prayer in our meetings. We open in prayer and we close in prayer. Zip open, zip closed. And we may tack on a help me Jesus here and there, but that's really not what we have in mind. The second principle that correlates to that is this basic idea, and that is that a prayer culture always emanates from the epicenter of church leadership. In recent years, I've begun working with, instead of speaking in a lot of different places during the year, some key churches, key areas, where we go in 4 or 5 times a year. And one of the first things I ask those pastors in those churches is, how much time does your leadership team spend praying? And secondly, what kind of prayer is it? And what I mean by that is, if you don't have a praying leadership culture, you're not going to have a praying church culture. And there is a difference between getting together as pastors and just praying about things versus seeking the Lord, if you understand what I'm saying. What you see in the early church is that they spent extensive amounts of time seeking the Lord. Again, a classic example is Acts 13. They didn't have an agenda. They weren't necessarily praying for the needs of the body, although that's a valuable thing. They were fasting and ministering to the Lord. And so what I have come to learn, and I've found it to be true in my ministry and the churches I work with, is the key to having a praying church is to have a praying leadership team. Now, this is not legalistic. There's no formula for how much time. All we're saying is that when it begins in your leadership team, it then begins to go viral into every area of the church. When you and your youth team, your youth pastors, your children's directors, whoever it might be in your church, are experiencing a dynamic, life-giving reality of prayer, it will be automatic that they will want to take that then into their own realms of ministry. I think so very easy for us to do is to think about prayer as something we're going to try to start out in the congregation instead of it beginning right in the hub of church life. We do the same in our families, of course. We do well at praying in church and in gatherings. Hard to pray at home, isn't it? Same principle is true when it comes to the church, that it always starts at the epicenter of leadership. These 6 stages, you don't have to write them down, but I wanted to process those with you because as I think about our role as pastors in leadership, there's kind of a journey that I've thought of over the years. First of all, pastors, many of them start at the level of what I call cooperation. Every pastor is cooperative. You have some people who want to have a prayer ministry in the church, and we cooperate. We say, sure, we'll put an announcement in the bulletin, we'll give you a room, we'll give you an attaboy every once in a while, and that's okay. The second one is a concern. Pastor begins to feel a concern for prayer, and he might preach on it. He might read some books on it. He might encourage people to become more serious about it. Thirdly, I think it then kind of kicks up a notch to the level of commitment. He begins to initiate some prayer strategies or events, and he's feeling a deep commitment to that. But the game changer, I believe, is conviction, where a pastor gets to the point where he says, my church has to become a house of prayer, and it's only going to get there if I lead it, if I have a deep conviction that this is how ministry is done. And that becomes really, I think, the game changer for every pastor. I think out of that then flows a competency in leading prayer. Again, many of us haven't been schooled or trained very well in terms of how a biblical balanced prayer experience should look. But I think over time, the Holy Spirit, who's very eager to teach us, is willing to do so, gives us a greater competency in that. And then these all start with C because I went to seminary. You know how it is. But it kind of goes into a contagion, a real movement of prayer in the church. And I only put that up there to encourage you to ask yourself, where am I in my leadership? Where am I as I'm giving direction to our staff? Where am I in terms of my response to the call for our church to be a house of prayer? And I do believe that conviction moment is so very, very vital. And I often say this, that conviction really can come either through crisis or through cultivation. Again, God is usually orchestrating the crisis, although I've created a few of my own over the years. But we can, on the other hand, cultivate a passion for prayer. And as I was a pastor, I realized that the more I developed relentless rhythms of praying, not only in my own life, but with my people, with my leaders, that conviction began to deepen and deepen and deepen, particularly, brothers, when we have a worship-based approach to prayer. Because our sense of neediness comes out of our understanding of his worthiness, doesn't it? And the more we are seeking him for who he is, the more like Isaiah of old and many others, the more we see our own need, our own desperation, and we cultivate that as a lifestyle. So it always emanates from the epicenter of church leadership. Let me say one other thing very practically. It just comes to my mind. The three churches I pastored, I inherited elder boards or elder teams that actually weren't elders. They were actually trustees, and I'm sure that sounds very familiar to some of you. They were board members. They had been selected based upon their professional background or their expertise in finance, whatever the case is. And what I learned is that in order to have a praying church, you have to retool the culture of that leadership team. And that's where we continued to come back to Acts chapter 6 and verse 4, that we as elders have to be men of prayer and the word with an eye toward equipping others to lead. And sometimes that takes time. In time, you have to trade out some people on those boards. You have to keep kind of turning up the pressure that this is how we do ministry. It's got to be prayer, and it's got to be the word, and it's got to be empowering others to lead. One sidebar along that line that may encourage you, if you look at Acts chapter 6 and verse 4, their yeses were prayer, the word, and empowering, as we've said. But if you think of an Old Testament parallel, and I know many of you have thought of this, you think of Moses when he was judging too many people. And his father-in-law, Jethro, by the way, that's the number one baby name in Cleveland I read this week. No, it's really not. But I just saying if you're still with me. But Jethro came to him and gave him some advice. And if I were to ask the average crowd, what was Jethro's advice? 99.9% of respondents would say his advice was to appoint additional judges. But if you've looked at the text, you realize that was the third thing he told Moses to do. In Exodus 18:19, once he had his attention, he said, "Now Moses, do this, and the Lord will be with you." By the way, if you study the scripture and what it actually says about this thing we call leadership today, you'll find that that five-word description was true of every person of influence throughout the scripture. The Lord was with him. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, David, Solomon in his good years, the good kings, the good judges, said of John the Baptist and others, the Lord was with him. This sense of the manifest presence and blessing of God. And here's what Jethro said to Moses. "Moses, now that I have your attention, number one, represent the people before God." What is that? That's prayer, right? "Secondly, teach them the statutes of the Lord," and that is the ministry of truth and the word and teaching. "Thirdly," he says, "appoint judges." What's fascinating to me is that in both Exodus and in Acts, you have the same three priorities in the same order. And that has to be the kind of conviction that grips our hearts when it comes to leading our churches in prayer and developing a leadership core in the way of prayer as well. All right, so I hope that's helpful to you. Number three, a prayer culture is fueled by experience and not explanation. Fueled by experience, not explanation. Again, I think too many of us often believe that if we will do a series on prayer once a year, if we will encourage people to read prayer books, that we'll have a praying church, and that usually develops well-informed minds, but not a praying people. I have a good friend in Rockland, California, pastors a church there. And a number of years we were talking, he said, "Daniel, a couple years ago, I preached on prayer 52 Sundays. I said, "Dude, man, I don't have 52 sermons on prayer. That's amazing." He said, "Yeah." He said, "It was hard work, but I did it." I said, "How'd that work for you?" He said, "It didn't." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Basically, all I did was increase the difference between their learning and their doing. They had all kinds of great ideas about prayer, but I didn't see anything really changed." I said, So what are you doing now? He said, I had an ingenious idea. I started praying, and I invited them to join me. And I said, "How's that working for you?" He said, "It's going great." He says, "Because I realized the only way people learn to pray is by praying." He used an analogy of a Little League baseball coach who wants his team to win, has a passion for them to excel, so he gets them together once a week, and he gives them a great speech on baseball, the history of baseball, the heroes of baseball, the hope of baseball, 3-point outline starting with the same letter. He gives a good poem on baseball. He holds up a baseball. He swings a bat. He shows them a glove. And then he sends them all home to practice by themselves. And he can't figure out why his team never wins. You say, "Man, that coach is a fry short of a Happy Meal, isn't he?" But in reality, let's be honest, that's sometimes how we approach prayer in our church, isn't it? We inspire them with speeches and ideas and precepts and concepts. We even model prayer for them in a public service. But one thing we fail to do is showing them how to pray by praying with them. And one of the vital things that we want to do in developing a prayer culture is create life-giving experiences in the fabric of how we do ministry. A principle here that I would just suggest as kind of a sub-point to this is this idea that when you're seeking to build a culture of prayer, to build the sidewalks where the footpaths already exist, all right? And again, I think so many times we create additional prayer activities, but one of the better things to do is to begin to allow people to have vital prayer experiences in the context in which they're already connecting and serving. And that way, the experience of prayer can begin to work its way into every fabric of the church. Now, of course, that assumes that the leaders of those ministries have a passion for prayer, can lead experiences of prayer, and even know how to facilitate those kinds of things. But I have learned that one of the most powerful things we can do as it relates to prayer is to build these prayer sidewalks where the footpaths already exist. One of the things I'm doing very actively, I did as a pastor and doing right now in Colorado, is training small group leaders and Sunday school class leaders as to how to lead a worship-based prayer experience in the context of their ministry. And you know that many of our small groups, the prayer time looks like this. It's 10 minutes of collecting requests about everybody's broken body parts, their trips they have planned, their pets that are not well, whatever it might be. And then we throw in a one-minute alley-oop at the end asking God to help us. But training people how to take the scripture, how to worship out of even one passage, how to turn that into then some vital praying prompted by the Spirit, and just seeing that integrated into every part of the life of the church is so essential to build a prayer culture. All right, let's go to the fourth principle here, one that I feel pretty passionate about. In order to have a vital prayer culture, we have to understand and really embrace in our hearts a clarity and conviction about community, a clarity and conviction about community. Many of you know Gene Getz, Dallas Seminary. He's written a number of books and a leader in the Bible church movement there. In his book, Praying Together, he makes this statement. He says, "I'm very grateful for all that has been written in our society about individual prayer, individual spirituality." He says, "But I'm concerned that we have not addressed the primary New Testament emphasis of corporate prayer and corporate spiritual experience." He says, "I believe the reason that is the case is because Western civilization is marked by rugged individualism." He goes on to say, "We are used to thinking in terms of I, me, and my, rather than we, our, and us." And he says, "The problem is that the primary context of the commands to prayer in the New Testament were initially applied and understood in community, not individualistically. But we have turned it around and made it the very opposite." I believe one of the problems behind our reluctance to lead our churches in prayer is we have lost the sense of conviction about the corporate nature of prayer. People often ask me, "Well, Daniel, which is more important, private prayer or corporate prayer?" My answer is yes, right? It's like asking, which leg do you need to walk on more, your right leg or your left leg? But what we have done in Western society, fundamentally, we have amputated our corporate prayer leg and we are lame on our private prayer leg. Getz goes on to say, "The reason it's so important is because most of us learn to practice vital spiritual disciplines on our own out of dynamic corporate experience." I have a son who's with me. His name's Jordan. You'll see him around. He works on our staff. He's a worship leader. He'll be helping us tomorrow morning. We're actually going to experience at 8 o'clock a life-giving prayer experience, praying out a text of Scripture, just enjoying that together to start our day. But Jordan has a passion for worship. So the question is, where did he get that passion? Well, it's obvious that he went out into a field one day and stood under a tree, and suddenly a worship apple fell on his head, and he started singing Matt Redman songs. It was amazing, right? No, that's not how it happens. He got that passion out of community, didn't he? He saw what worship was doing in the hearts of people as their thoughts were filled with truths about Christ and their hearts were engaged in this deep encounter with the Lord. He said, "You know, I want to do that." But again, so often like that baseball coach, we just expect people to figure that out on their own. We write an e-devotion that we send out every Monday, and a couple of years ago, I wrote one titled, If I Was the Devil. Some of you appreciate this. As I was typing it, my wife walked by and she saw the title on the screen. She says, you know, some days I think you are. I said, get thee behind me, Satan. You know, I have a bad marital sparring. But what I said is that if I was the devil, I would perhaps focus my most devious and deliberate energy on trying to do everything possible to keep Christians from praying together. Because you see, the devil understands biblical promises. He understands biblical history. He understands church history. He knows that the great movements against his kingdom of darkness came during seasons of revival. And we know there has never been a major revival that did not begin in movements of united prayer. So if I was the devil, I would do everything I could to keep people from getting serious about that thing. And one of the ways I think he does it is that he has played us in this idea that prayer is primarily an individual experience versus a corporate experience. And I think it's both. Again, I'm not in any way negating our individual prayer lives. I'm just saying that we have pretty much taken out of the fabric of the church that essential conviction of the New Testament of praying together on a regular basis. I teach periodically at Liberty University in Virginia. In fact, next month going there to teach an intensive on prayer. And for whatever reason, at that particular university, I think it's because the co-founder, Elmer Towns, has been to South Korea quite a bit. But they have a lot of students from South Korea there. And very often you'll hear them come up to an American student saying, why do you pray by yourself? It just does not even register with them that that would be our primary paradigm. And as you know, 5 o'clock every day, the prayer chapel is filled with the sound of Korean praise and those Koreans praying together. And Goetz goes on to say, basically, that's fundamentally New Testament. I think one of the things we don't realize is that prior to the printing press, the only way to receive truth was in community, wasn't it? I mean, primarily you had to be there, and it was audible learning. We now have our own personal copy of Scripture, which is a wonderful thing, but we have obviously turned much of what was designed to be community experience into an individualistic approach. And I believe at that point the devil really has us. Not only the individualism, but I think he loves it when we do try to get together and the prayer meetings are not very life-giving. One of my friends says that the main reason most people in our churches don't go to prayer meetings at our church is because they've been to prayer meetings at our church, right? And we need an approach that's going to truly be transformational as we lead them. I had an elder one time who said to me, Daniel, I'm not coming to those prayer meetings at our church. And I said, why not, Bob? He said, well, two reasons. Number one, the Bible says don't pray to be seen by men. And if I came, I would just be coming, you know, for show. I said, okay. I said, what's the second reason? He said, well, the Bible says stay home and pray in your closet. So I'm going to stay home and pray by myself. I said, well, would you like some feedback, Bob? And of course, he's an elder. He could demand my resignation in the next meeting. So I had to be kind. But I said, would you like some feedback? He said, sure. I said, well, number one, why don't you change your motive and come? There's lots of other motives you can choose other than being seen by men. And you have the power to do that. And I said, secondly, Bob, we need to renovate your closet because that baby is way too small. Let me give you just a little glimpse of something that may sound very countercultural to us, but I would challenge you to think about it, study it. In one of my books, Fresh Encounters, we have several chapters on this. But I do believe that when it comes to Matthew chapter 6, many people take that idea of the prayer closet and actually use it as an excuse not to pray with others. When this may be a little mind-blowing, it actually is an argument to pray with others. If you look at the context, Jesus is doing group instruction. He's on the Sermon on the Mount addressing his core disciples and those who would be disciples. And when he gets to prayer, he says, and when you pray, in the plural, it's y'all. All right, you guys know the Greek is very specific. When y'all pray, don't pray like those guys, the Pharisees who have the wrong motive, right? And he says, don't pray like those guys, the publicans who have the wrong method, thinking their God will hear them for their many words. Your Father knows what you need before you ask. But then he turns to his disciples and says, and when y'all, all y'all, or yuns all, depending on where you're from, when you pray, go into your, the Greek word is tameion. It's just a general word for an inner room, even a storehouse or a warehouse is the idea. Go into your tameion, and when you have shut the door, and where your Father sees in secret, and again, I believe that that not only is a reference to the contrast of praying in public on the street corners, but it's also a reference to the secrecy of the heart. And there are some singular pronouns there, and we don't have time to get into it. But I do think in Jewish thought, praying in community and it being a very private experience was not mutually exclusive. I think sometimes we have created a dichotomy there. But he says, and when you go to pray, pray this way. And you all obviously know the first word of the prayer. It's not my, it's our. All the pronouns of the prayer are plural. Now, I don't know too many people who pray in plural pronouns when they're alone unless they're on some medication. But in reality, Jesus is setting them up to experience prayer in community and pray, our Father, art in heaven, give us this day. You say, well, how did they play that out? Well, they obviously played it out in the upper room, right? The text doesn't say when the day of Pentecost was finally come, everyone was in a private prayer cubicle and they heard a wind, so they hurried up and got together in the upper room. No, they were all together in one place. That was the common understanding of their approach toward prayer. And I would suggest to you that many times we have done just the opposite. A little story on the side that Alistair would appreciate. When my wife turned 40, I took her to Scotland. That's also my heritage. And while we were over there, we were touring a number of palaces and castles, if you've been to that part of the world. One of them was Holyrood House on Princess Street there in Edinburgh. And before we took the tour, there was a big plaque, a big sign outside. Maybe you've been there. And it listed the things we were going to tour. One of the things we were going to tour, it listed, was the King's Closet and the Queen's Closet. And I turned to my wife, I said, why are we looking in their closets? That's kind of weird, isn't it? Maybe her crowns or robes, maybe she has more shoes than Imelda Marcos, I don't know. So we went through this tour, and about halfway through, we came to a room, maybe 40 by 40, 35 by 35, beautifully furnished chairs and tables and lamps and sofas. And the tour guide said, this is the King's Closet. To be called into the King's Closet is a rare privilege. In his closet, the king would meet with friends, dignitaries, relatives. And you can imagine that just was sounding weird to me, right? I went to the next room and it was decorated a little more nicely because guess whose closet that was? Yeah, it was the Queen's Closet. Same speech. In the closet, the queen would meet with, you know, friends, dignitaries, etc. So this is really bugging me. I finally raised my hand and I said, do you mean to tell me that back when this palace was built, a closet was actually a meeting room? He said, yes, that was exactly the primary meaning of the word. And had I been a cartoon character, boom, you know, light bulb would have gone off. Interestingly enough, the same king who authorized the only version that uses the word closet, the 1611 King James Version, is the same king who built Holyrood House Palace. I believe those little nuances make a world of difference in our understanding of what we're supposed to be doing when we pray. And I would encourage you, brothers, to have a deep conviction that we have to do this together. This cannot just be something we assign to the retired brothers to do on Monday morning. This can't just be something a prayer department does. This must be the essence of the life of the church. And as a pastor giving myself continually to prayer and the ministry of the word, I must lead these experiences because we know that in many cases the spiritual battle is won or lost at that point. All right? Next idea, as we finish up here, just a few more very quickly. A prayer culture is sustained by the right motive. By the right motive. And let's be honest, we can do the right things for the wrong reasons, can't we? Many of us have a variety of motives, and I know I do. Maybe I'm probably in worse shape than a lot of you. Sometimes it can be guilt. We feel guilty if we don't pray. Obviously, that's not the mark of a vital relationship. Sometimes approval, wanting to be a good pastor. If I pray more, my people will think I'm a good guy. Sometimes, let's be honest, it's church growth. I'll be very candid. When I first got out of seminary, I was really into prayer. And to be honest, what's going on in my mind, you know, if I pray, God will bless me. If he blesses me, he'll bless my church. If he blesses my church will grow. My church grows, I'll get written up in the alumni newsletter. I know none of you would ever be that carnal, but that's what was percolating in my heart. And one of my mentors, a guy named Peter Lord, one time sat with a group of us and he said, if God promised you two things, number one, you'll go to heaven when you die. I like that promise. But number two, he'll never use you in the ministry again. Would you still pray? Now, I know it's a hypothetical question, but for me, it was so convicting because I realized that so many times I pray because I want God to use me for me. So I began to realize it can't even be church growth. Then I got really spiritual and I got this virus called Ravenhillitis. Anybody ever had that before? All these Leonard Ravenhill books, revival, and even led conferences on revival, very actively involved in that until one day, a guy at one of the conferences I was in charge of burst my bubble at this point too. He got up and he said, there's a difference between seeking revival from God and seeking God for revival. And I began to realize, oh, we want revival, but even that can't be the motivation. I mean, let's say we had a wonderful, glorious revival that broke out across North America in 2015. Now, the question is, 10 years later, once it begins to subside, you know, would we still be praying with the same passion? So for years, I led the men in our church in a Monday morning men's prayer time, 6 a.m. Now, you're saying, Henderson, you really are not very smart, right? I didn't pick that time. They did. And I told them, I'll be there. But you can imagine after long Sundays, multiple services, all the stuff we go through on Sundays, at 5 in the morning on Mondays, I did not feel like getting up. I remember one Monday morning I got up and I said, Lord, why am I doing this prayer thing? This is really hard. Boy, it's battle. Guys don't show up. They're not faithful. You know, it's just really tough. I know the enemy hates it. And I don't hear voices, of course. I don't see handwriting on the wall. But the impression that came to my heart in the days to follow was that my motivation was rooted in things that changed, like how many people came, you know, how I felt about the prayer meeting, what kind of tangible answers we had. And what hit me that has literally changed the trajectory of my life is that my motivation had to be rooted in something that never changed. And I've come to believe that the only enduring motive for prayer is that God is worthy to be sought. The only enduring motive for prayer is that God is worthy to be sought, and that is the worship-based approach to prayer. In fact, think about this. The only kind of prayer that's eternal is not praying for the lost. It's not praying for the sick. It's not spiritual warfare or whatever kinds of praying you do. But one day when we get to heaven, we'll be saying what? Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. And He is worthy. And when that is my motivation, that God is worthy to be sought, it never changes. The weather may be good, it may be bad, there may be 3 men, there may be 300 men. It really doesn't matter. He is worthy to be sought. And I believe to lead a culture of prayer, which requires great sustained passion, it must be rooted in the worthiness of our God to be sought through the privilege of prayer. Number 6, a prayer culture is a key to supernatural mission achievement. For whatever reason, in my pastoral ministry, I pastored churches that were larger. They weren't superior, they were just bigger. In fact, a friend of mine says the main difference between a big church and a little church is like the difference between a big dog and a little dog. The big dog just has more fleas, right? And sometimes it's that way. But one of the things I learned out of pastoring these large churches, and I think many of you would believe this, is that many of our churches today can continue to run apart from God's blessing, just on the mere momentum of the numbers and the programming and the staff talent and the dynamic of what happens on the platform, et cetera. And we see these tragic stories of pastors who for years were not walking with the Lord, some living in sin, yet the church just kept on going and going and going and going. I think all of us want really to see God do something supernatural in our churches. And when we wait on the Holy Spirit, when we seek the Lord, His Spirit is a witness-bearing spirit. The church I pastored in Minnesota was renowned for its missions program, and they often would say, we are a missionary church. But we changed that to say we are a praying missionary church. Because, you know, you can be a missionary church and not a praying church and be doing a whole lot of global enterprise that may have nothing to do with really the prompting and energy of the Holy Spirit. On the other hand, you can be a praying church that's not a missionary church, and it's very obvious something is going awry in your praying. But when we pray rightly, not only are we sharing our heart with God, but He's sharing His heart with us. And His Holy Spirit is a witness-bearing spirit and should, as it did in Acts, and as it always must when we pray appropriately, result in supernatural mission achievement. Finally, the prayer culture is more a crockpot than a microwave. It's much more a crockpot than a microwave. It takes years and years and years to develop a culture of prayer in our churches. And at that point, we struggle. We live in an instant gratification society. We want to see results. But the fact of the matter is we have to continue to pray and continue to seek the Lord and continue to see that, as I call it, the prayer virus begin to spread one heart at a time, one heart at a time. I wish we had time to talk specifically about leading effective prayer times. It's one of my favorite topics because it's something I really didn't learn in seminary. I would encourage you to join us tomorrow at 8, as we'll just be praying through a text, embedding worship into that, probably what a lot of you do anyway in your churches, but maybe a model that would be an encouragement to you. But I trust that the Lord will help us to have a conviction, a resolute passion to not just have a church with a prayer program, but a church that is really defined by a culture of prayer, beginning with our leadership, being fueled by life-giving experience where we are really leading transformational prayer times and teaching others to do the same in their areas of ministry. We have a conviction that not only should we have individual prayer lives, but we must pray together, because this is the essence of New Testament Christianity, and truly continuing to believe that the Lord wants us to be motivated by that which is focused on His worthiness will result in a supernatural mission achievement and really is our commitment for a lifetime. I close with one final anecdote. One of those Monday mornings I was referring to, alarm goes off at 5 o'clock, and I asked the Lord a different question. I said, "Lord, how long do I have to keep doing this prayer thing? I mean, you know, again, this is grueling, it's tough. Can I get reassigned as a cruise ship chaplain or something? That sounds a little more inviting. You know, again, I don't hear voices or anything, but just the promptings of my heart over these next few days, so typical of the Lord, is that He made me begin to ponder some questions. It was as if He said, "Well, Daniel, how long are you gonna brush your teeth, put on deodorant, take a shower, eat breakfast, comb your hair?" That was a number of years ago, obviously. Comb your hair, get dressed. You know, how long are you gonna do that? The answer's obvious, right? Till the day I die. He said, "Well, then if you've already settled the issue on those really mundane matters, when are you gonna settle this issue? Why would you be asking a question like that about something so powerful and vital as leading my people into my presence?" And I think so often as pastors, we think about how we want to die, you know, and I think probably one of our dreams, if you could pick the way to die, would be go out preaching, right? "The Lord said," boom, there he goes, out with a flame of glory, hallelujah. Any guys ever seen someone die while they're preaching? No? Yeah, one, okay. Any of you thought you were going to die when someone else was preaching? Let's see your hands up. Yeah, I got that one. Yeah, maybe now, right? But I say to pastors all the time, what we really need to do is develop a dream of dying on our knees. Just resolve it. Till the day I die, this is what I do. Because this is what it means to be a New Testament pastor. That I have a conviction about prayer, that we're going to do it in community because that's the way the church functions. I'm going to do it because God is worthy to be sought. I'm going to be resolute about this, and I'm going to believe that God's going to use this to advance the work of the gospel in supernatural power for His glory. So I trust that's been an encouragement to you, brothers. We have 5 minutes. I know this is a bigger room, but are there any questions anybody want to ask? Questions, comments, suggestions, snide remarks? We're an equal opportunity receptor here. Yes, sir. Question. Great question.
And just how far you can go with public and specific.
Yeah, that's a good word too. Let me just tell you real briefly, I'm a big fan, and I think you are too, I know you are, of the model that Jesus gave us. I think when He said pray this way, it wasn't a suggestion. And I've used all kinds of other models, axe, cats, flax, slacks, whatever, you know, they all have to spell something. But if you look at the Lord's Prayer, and I've got a musical background, and in a number of my books, we unpack this. I call it the 4-4 pattern. If you're musical at all, you'll immediately know what I'm talking about. It starts upward, then downward, then inward, then outward, the 4-4 pattern. If you look at the Lord's Prayer, I think a pattern for biblical balanced prayer begins upward with "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." I call that reverence. Downward in response, they all start with R because I went to seminary. A reverence and then response, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven," which is surrender and submission to God's kingdom purposes. Certainly could include confession, anything inconsistent with His kingdom rule in our lives. And then it goes inward with request, "Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses." Those deal with resource and relationship issues. Again, confession vital in that element of it. And then there's the outward part I call readiness, because of the anticipatory tone of it. "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." And then in the majority text, of course, it goes back up, "For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever." So reverence, response, request, readiness. So when I lead prayer, it's almost as if I have that pattern on my lens. I look at a text of Scripture. I believe every prayer meeting personal opinion, shouldn't start with asking, does anybody have any prayer requests? Let's just pray as we feel led. That can always get you in trouble because they're led by a lot of strange things at times. I think every prayer meeting starts, let's open our Bible and let's practice this pattern Jesus gave us. And I think, as you know and I know, not only does that pattern evoke some confession at certain points of it, but the Word of God is going to be penetrating our hearts as we're praying out of the Scripture, bringing us to that point. Your question is, how appropriate is confession in mixed groups, et cetera? And that just obviously takes discretion and guiding that in a particular way so that the things that are said aren't going to be threatening or in any way inappropriate. But if we don't have a lot of time in a prayer meeting, I'll just be real basic with you. I mean, you guys know this, the Lord's Prayer is broken into two halves. The first half is Godward, the second half is manward. And so the way I say that, He is worthy and we are needy. And so when I train small group leaders on prayer, I train them just to take a passage of Scripture, might even be one verse, and ask, what does this verse tell us about God and His character? And let's spend the first few minutes worshiping Him out of that text. And then what does it tell us about our need? And let's take the second half, just declaring we are needy and bringing our needs to Him based upon a principle or a promise in that passage. So the mantra that I use, is Scripture-fed, Spirit-led, worship-based prayer. And certainly when you follow the pattern Jesus gave, there are multiple points of confession there. I know some people say, well, we should always start in confession, and anything that you obviously are aware of that is going to inhibit your relationship with the Lord needs to be confessed. But I also find that when you begin with worship, there are things that are exposed in your life that you wouldn't normally think of coming out of the Scripture that brings great conviction and clarity about your need to align your life with His will. Yeah. Got time for one more quick question, if there is one. Anybody at all?
Prayer.
Yes, sir. Where?
Prayer.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
You have an example of the prayer culture that you're teaching us about in your personal life.
Yes, and it'll take a little bit of time to do it, but the three churches I inherited, all three increasingly began to experience that. And the church in California particularly, where we had, I think you're here at the beginning, these prayer summits three times a year. There were 12 different prayer meetings being led by other people. There was a weekly prayer time. The forms can change. You know what I'm saying? In other words, that doesn't mean it has to be an all-church prayer meeting. In fact, one thing I have learned, especially traveling and watching what the Lord has done with Pastor Cimbala there, is that in an already established church, the all-church prayer meeting is rarely the engine of the prayer culture. It usually in time becomes the expression of the prayer culture. And what I mean by that, calling an all-church prayer meeting and expecting that to drive the prayer culture in an already very busy church with all kinds of programming, etc., is often not realistic. But when you're building prayer sidewalks where the footpaths already exist, then that's where it begins to get very, very dynamic. The church we're in Colorado, we're seeing some great advancements there. And the evidence of that is the young people are spending much more time together in prayer. Their youth pastors are leading them accordingly. The children's ministry is doing the same. Small groups are being trained to embed prayer into the culture. And so it's you can't equate it by the number of prayer meetings, but clearly you realize that coming out of the core leadership team, there is this passion to see prayer get it embedded into every program of the church. So I'd be glad to talk to you more about some of those as well. Yeah, it's a great question. All right, let me pray. Thank you, brothers, for your time. And let's trust the Lord to do something very rich and deep in our hearts as we go from here. Father, we want to thank you for your word. And I think all of us at this conference have a particular love for the preaching of the truth and for the declaration of the gospel. But Lord, we often find that like a plane requires two wings. One wing can sometimes be longer than the other. And Lord, we need your grace, because left to ourselves, we are very independent. And so, Lord, as the disciples prayed, we likewise would ask you, teach us to pray. Teach us to be like those disciples who were resolute, that they would give themselves collectively as a leadership team to prayer, and that out of the epicenter of that experience would come dramatic exploits. Just as has happened in Acts 6, Lord, the word of God spread. The number of disciples multiplied greatly. A great many priests became obedient to the faith. Lord, we long to see that kind of gospel impact in our day. And we pray that we would seek you and trust you to do that which only you can do, as we are men and women And as we lead churches from the position of trusting and depending on you, we pray this in Christ's name and for his glory. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. See you in 15 minutes.